Hey all, welcome to Weekly System Design. Today we are going to do notification service. This would be a open discussion, would be leading and Rabani is going to lead that open discussion. So I think everybody can discuss their viewpoints and thoughts in this, and but Rabani would be the lead of and moderator of this. So with this, I would like to hand it over to Rabani.
Hi guys. My name is Rabani. So last week we had an open discussion on Twitter search, and it was quite insightful. So I thought maybe we should do something on the same lines with the notification service. On the SDA Skills channel, if you go back and see, you will find a session already done on notification skills. And that was a mock interview. So this is going to be an open discussion. Ideas and whatever you feel like could contribute to the direction in which we are going, or any pitfalls that you see and or you have discussed with someone else would be highly appreciated and welcome. Another thing, this is my first session, so bear with me. Okay, so let's get on with this session. So the requirements, let's start with the requirements that what we usually seek out of a service whose primary job is to notify a bunch of people, be it systems, through different methodologies, be it over HTTP, be it on the form of SMS or email. So if we start with the requirements. Pitch in, guys, if you also feel that we need some of the other requirements or not. So what we at the first on a very basic level, we get an input from the client, and for a client for a particular topic, and we need to notify a bunch of systems, or let's
Rabani,
say,
increase the font. Can you increase the font a little bit?
Is this visible?
One
System.
suggestion here is like maybe instead of writing sentences, write some key points and
Other thing would be subscribers have already subscribed to a topic, and what else? One more thing that this notification service needs to have is that each input has priority with it, so we need to handle P1, P2, P3. P1 being highest and P3 being lowest. The method, what else? The method, how am I going to deliver this notification to all my systems or the subscribers is that, let's say, we deliver it over email and then API call or HTTPS.
So Ravani, so who is my customer here? So generally, I think that's the first question I ask myself. Who is my customer and for whom I'm going to build this?
So our customer here are two people. So one is other systems that are relying on a particular notification to kick in something that they want to do. if something happens on the systems that they have deployed.
No, so that means you are telling like we are building this as a very general notification service. So anybody, any two parties could come in.
Yes.
The publisher and the subscribers and can onboard on the system, and they could get. So this is like this might be a cloud service then. That's
yes.
What.
Yes.
Okay. So
yes.
The scope is like anybody. So I'm open to anybody, general or a public, that come on. I will give you onboarding experience, and then because this would now change the scale of the system. Like say
yes.
We are only building this for some app like Facebook or something, then the scale would be different. Then the problem space would be like only Facebook would be using this or somebody other app.
Yeah.
Okay, so good to know. Okay.
Yeah. So thanks, Asim, for clearing that up. So yes, this will be presented as a service for anyone that need to have a PubSub model or a notification or service that they can use. And they can receive that alerts or events over email. So this could be me as a developer who signs up and says, okay, you know what, I need to get an email with certain metrics or with certain things that the other system that is generating this alert, and I want that metric as an email to delivered to me, or I want that metric to be delivered as soon as it happens to a number of systems so that they know that something has occurred over another system. So yes, this is a very general service which can be used by both systems as well as people.
So I didn't get that HTTP API HTTPS call. So, and I also think the delivery could be more, the subscriber should have more options like SMS, email, or more options rather than email.
So okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. Like I had initially thought of something, or yeah, we can include API or an SMS as well.
Yeah, but that again should be, I think, generic. Anybody can come with some other means of delivery. Would say like, oh, I want something else. So it should work in that way. Or I think for now, it is fine to just scope it to email and SMS. But still, I didn't understand this API HTTPS call.
Okay. So I had initially thought of when I was thinking of this as a general service. So I had initially thought of people would like to, and the user would like to get the notification as a call to one of their endpoints, as a post call to one of their endpoints in a system.
So user and itself call.
Sorry?
So user will itself call the endpoint. Like if I'm the subscriber, and I'm subscribed to you, so, and I'm not available right now, nothing by email or SMS. So when I will be available, I'll just make an API call and pull everything. Is that what you are saying?
Yes. Like to some extent, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Another reason, another thing on the line I'm saying is that, let's say if some failure occurs on one of my system, and I have a bunch of systems who want to be, you know, readily aware that some failure has occurred on this platform because they depend on it. So I can call them and tell them that this service has failed. So I can just do a post call on those endpoints. So when the subscriber register for a call through an API call, they have to provide an endpoint saying that call on this endpoint on that. Or if it complicates, we can remove the API call if that is being not clear with the scope.
Yeah, right now, okay. I'm not clear with the API.
Is this notification as a service or is it something internal notification are we talking about?
Notification as a service, actually.
Okay, then one of the requirements that I would like to add is if it is notification as a service, the consumer, whoever it might be,
mm-hmm.
or the publisher. Sorry, not in both cases. Like there needs to be a way for publisher to register itself with this service and let that what topics it needs to publish. And it should also give consumer, and which is kind of what Aseem said, like consumer can select what topics it needs to subscribe and what method it needs to receive that notification, like SMS, email.
So register for a topic and inform about the mode of delivery. Consumers, producers can create topic. Anything else anyone wants to add?
I think, Mohammed, I think I see your point in your requirement for adding API. I think we folks know we completely did not understand. Correct me if I'm wrong. The subsequent dependent applications for any particular workflow, if they are dependent on the particular notifications, the SMS email is only for take a message to the users, right? If there is any instrumentation automation done to for an end-to-end process flow, the notification services should be able to send the output to the dependent downstream applications that can do some kind of processing from there, right?
So that's correct. That was my original idea.
Sense, actually.
Yeah, that was my actually original idea, but. Yeah, we can take it up. I think even if we add an API, we won't complicate much. So let's start with notification over email and SMS, and then we can
add the API. You have the design in your mind, I think let's go with that.
No issues. Anything else anyone wants to add regarding the requirements that they we can have with such a notification service?
So to summarize, what we have discussed, like producers can create the channels or topics, whatever they would put messages or notifications in that, and whoever is subscribing would get notified based on that, right? So how about if the or might be that could be non-functional, like how long will keep the messages?
I have decided, thought about that we will keep a message for around 30 minutes. If we face any failure, if we are able to deliver outright, we don't save it.
So there are two things here, that as soon as message came and I was able to send to subscriber and I'm done.
Yes.
And other thing is if subscriber is not available or there is some other thing like SMS channel is not up or email is not there, then how long will store it, like for 15 days, 30 days? So we need to give a subscriber a chance to wake up. So in that case, let's say on Facebook, if you are not logged in, you will not get notified. So once you log in after 10 days, you will get notified. So do we want to keep notifications forever, or like if user is coming after 15 days, we don't show old notifications?
So we can keep the notifications in the tray for I would say 30 minutes or 1 hour at max, not more than that, is the idea that I have. Anyway, if we are storing the message for a particular amount of time, be it for 30 minutes or 10 days. If the design is there, then we can tweak around with the time for which the message is stored, if I'm not wrong.
No, I think 30 minutes is a really short window to start with.
So
think about as a user on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're logging in after 30 minutes, so you will miss all the notifications which are generated meanwhile. Let's say you have a friend request notification. Okay. And you log in after 30 minutes and then it won't show you. You might see it in your somewhere else in your friend list, but the whole purpose of notifying is like whenever you log in or you're online, you will get immediate notified about some event.
That
is notification as a service. It can be consumer specific and it can be tied to monetization or how long the messages need to be kept. But 30 minutes is definitely short.
Okay. Fine. I get the idea behind that. Okay, that's helpful, guys. Thank you. I think these are all the requirements I'll have from my system, from a notification service.
You want to do like something like estimates or non-functional, how many messages are coming in, out. Because like you said, this is a cloud service. So the scale could go really high in this case. And then I don't know, how you want to keep it regionalized for a region, or you want to keep it like across the globe. Then if it is across the globe, then there would be other things to be considered.
I did not think in the direction of keeping it across the globe in terms of multiple regions.
That's fine. We can even start with one region. We can pick any region to start with. We can pick like a Europe region to start with or US region. But that would tell us like what is the scale of the system. So that would be estimates or non-functional requirements.
I would like to start with functional requirements and then move on to
I think the functional requirements generally what I've seen is the one which you wrote up that are already covered. What is the function of the system? Now we might be talking about estimates. Estimates and in non-functional, it would be like availability, consistency, and other things.
For non-functional, I have noted down a couple of things.
Yeah. So you want highly available, highly consistent in that way. We can think about it.
We would like to have this scalable actually, for sure. And after that, we like to have it highly available. Although it's covered, it's given the requirement, but we really want the priority to be handled in the way it is given in the requirements, so that we want P1 to be delivered as soon as it gets in, as compared to P2 and P3. So I think that's there in the requirement. So we don't need to have it in non-functional.
So looks like you have something like priority, but do you think this system should be highly consistent or highly available is only needed right now?
So highly available is my priority as of now.
Mm-hmm.
Consistency can take a hit actually.
Yeah, if your message is going out in few milliseconds or second, then that's fine, I think.
Yeah.
This is not...
In terms of non-functional requirements, I have only three requirements that... I need this to be very highly scalable and available, and I'm not very much concerned about the consistency. So with that in mind, I have the design.
Okay. How about your estimates now?
So I haven't actually gone through a lot of estimates, to be honest. while I was thinking about it. So in terms of notification service, okay, we also missed one requirement, is that each message size is of 5 KB. I would like to discuss this. How would you go about with the estimations of a notification service?
Because so, first of all, how many topics you have, or like or yeah, so before that, how many publishers could be, and how much on average they are sending messages, so, and how many subscribers? So there could be like your users, total number of users and active users, and then how many channels or topics you are thinking about. So there could be so many things here, and which can define the nature of the
metrics
system.
I would add, like, since it's notification as a service, you can come small, medium, large, and come up with the numbers for that for the customers to choose, because you're going to provide as a service, right?
Yes.
So
small, medium, large, as in like we are comparing them with the number of notifications that they will send.
You spin up Elasticsearch, you go to Elasticsearch website and you want to spin up in cloud. So there is a free tier which gives you certain computing power and certain number of messages that you can publish, like that, right? So if you are paying, then it's a different system that they spin up for you in the cloud. So since you are providing as a service, I would personally go via that route and come up with the numbers for each type of service that you're going to provide.
Yeah, that's a good point. But I think for now, like VT made a good point, but I think right now we can skip going on free tier or this, because we have so many things.
Right now we can just go with like one.
So we can estimate, so Aseem pointed out quite accurately that we can estimate the total total publishers or producers. On the platform, right? And
so,
then
so let's say they are your total producers could be like, I think for a, like we can start with the, or a low ball number, like could be 1 million active total producers.
Okay. Okay.
And if this is a higher number, we can make it small also, 100.
This works fine. We can do that. And we can say that on an average, each producer has three topics or four topics.
Yeah, let's say three topics. And every producer is putting like five messages per minute or second, whatever number you want to pick.
So then can we like just do like how many the count of topics and the size of the topic?
Yeah, this would define size of the topic.
Like, yeah, this would fine.
Rabani already mentioned 5 KB. So if 5 KB messages are coming and they have to store for 3 days, then number of messages into 5 KB and then 3 days will give us the storage estimate. Like this much storage I need. So if I don't have that much technology to store the data, that means we are going in the wrong direction.
Right.
Yeah. So also one more thing, guys. So when we are calculating this, so do we take on an average for each topic a producer? Can we take this as a metric that on an average, let's say for each topic a producer has four topics, and on an average for each topic they publish 10 times. So
yeah, you can say publish 10 times in a minute, day, whatever. Okay, day is also fine.
Yeah. So This will give us some metrics around.
So, but this would not give, when if I are going with a day thing, it might not give a good impression. Not a good impression. What I mean is, because it's a highly movable system. Data will come, data will go. So, and data should go away in few minutes, right? That is the goal. So your data storage layer might not even hold it for more than 1 hour or half hour.
Okay. Yeah.
So I think that's why, let's talk in minutes, like 10 or like 2 messages per minute.
Okay.
So in that way, we can say, see, 3 days is the max time, but our goal is to, it is our goal is to move the things as soon as possible out. And that means, like, I don't want to store it forever.
Okay. Fine.
But yeah, so that's what I was thinking. If you are taking 10 times, 10 messages, right?
Yeah, 10 topics.
No, you roll 4 topics and 10 messages.
Yeah, so for each topic, they publish 10 times. So 10 okay. messages.
Okay, so that means it would be for one producer, there would be 40 messages 40. Per yeah. minute. And if there are
40 publishers per minute, and if there are 1 million active in a day, so can reduce it by a minute, right?
So this would be really I think a big number, but still that is fine. You already mentioned a system is scalable, so in terms of scalability, we should be able to handle that.
So that would be 40.
And that is fine. If you don't want to go into calculations, we can proceed further. But how many consumers would be active? That is also one thing. So this system has to scale, I think, in 3 ways. One is like people who are sending messages, and then your storage layer should be able to handle the load. And then it has to even send the messages out. So that time also it should scale.
So I will just, since there's a notification service, I will just send the notification to the client. So the only requirement for the storage I would be having is in terms of a message store and in terms of storing the metadata for the client topic and the subscribers, I guess, right? So I actually haven't. I did not go about the estimations before.
So that is fine. I think that is a food for thought for if you're doing a real interview next time or even if you're presenting next time. But it's always good to check with your interviewer that you want to do estimates or not. So sometimes interviews say, yes, do it. They want to see how you judge the system based on scalability, because what my system would look like in few years, would I able to handle that much load or not? In this case, our storage only needs for 3 days and then we can archive. So we are not so bothered about storage in long run, but again, in 3 days also, it should sustain. It should not crash. So I think,
That's
another videos we did something similar, and I think we can move ahead already. Yeah, we spent a lot of time in requirements and estimate, but what I meant to say for everybody that think how you want to handle the estimates in a quick way. In real interview, you might not have more than 10 to 15 minutes to spend on requirements, functional, non-functional estimates.
Okay. Yeah.
And if you haven't done in the past, then in real interview it could be really tricky.
Okay. Yes. We will keep that thought in mind. Thanks. So I think we can move on to the design part of the system.
Yeah, let's do it.
What I've thought is that we have a client that so will.
I have a suggestion here, Vani.
Yeah,
I think you can copy all that stuff and put it here. So
yeah, I can do that.
Because then it's good for you also when designing that.
So hey, Rabani, I think for a functional requirement, does the service that notification, whatever that we produce, is it a actionable notification or not? I'm just thinking from the consumer perspective, right? If I get a notification on my
phone. So we do acknowledge that and then
We don't get the subsequent notifications. The system does not have to produce the additional notifications. If I timely acknowledge it. For some, if my job success completed successfully, I get a notification, but there is no action required. But for some, acknowledgement is required, right? Or, if I'm doing a banking transaction, the notification that I get is, enter a PIN number there, right? So that is a time bound, or, it's a responsive bound kind of notification. So just think about it.
I think for now we can keep it simple and without acknowledge is also fine. Until Sirvani, you want to keep it in that way, both acknowledge and non-acknowledge.
So I would like to keep it in non-acknowledgement way as of now, and we can add it later if that's fine.
But yeah, good point. There could be two types of notifications. Again, to think about if it is in a real interview, acknowledge or not acknowledge.
Okay. I'm getting good points. That is what I was expecting out of this discussion. So. Yeah, thanks, guys. Fine. I'll start with the design that I've thought of actually, and we can just discuss on that. So, we have a client here, and it will send some notification to us. So we'll have one application server here. I had noted down some functional requirements in terms of API points, that is create topic with topic name. Another would be subscribe. And that would be you have to pass on your SMS number. Email and then the topic name and subscriber ID, that is your unique ID. Other would be unsubscribe. You have subscribe ID and then topic name with which you don't want to subscribe, and the other would be notify. This would be the call the producers would be doing. So they'll have to pass in their client ID, the message, the topic name that they want to publish to. So these are all would be the endpoints that I'd be having for this service. Do we want to add any more endpoints or do we want to tweak any?
Actually, in subscribe, I didn't get why there is a SMS number or email. If client subscribed for a topic, then the consumer should get all the emails and SMS from the particular topic.
That's a good point, actually. We do not need this SMS number and email. But then we need to have an onboard subscribe to onboard a subscriber. Right, so that we can record these information. and then it will have a okay, now this makes more sense actually.
Are you allowing the user to create a topic or existing topic can be user subscribed?
Subscribers cannot create a topic, right? They can only subscribe to a topic. Clients can create a topic.
API name should be changed, right? Subscribe topic instead of create topic.
If a client wants to create a new topic, then they should be able to create, right? If I let's say I'm already a client and I want to create a new topic, I need to have a method to create the topic, right? We can have onboard client as well. So take client name. This looks any ideas, guys, or if you are seeing any gaps?
So create topic totally altogether, it will be create lots of overhead on the system. Okay, so you have to take the topic string, then you have to create mapping, all that, right? So are you going to do like that?
I am not getting the question, Shreya. So in the use case scenario is that I have created a new topic and I would like people to subscribe to the topic, and whoever has subscribed to the topic, any message sent to that topic will be received by them.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. But create topic means user also can allow to create a new topic.
I think who is a valid producer can create a topic. So, and I would say to folks, don't think as a Kafka topic, this could be different. The topic in that way is, I would say it's a channel. You are using my service. You can come and create a new channel as a user, and where you can start putting messages. As soon as you create a channel or a topic, we'll give you a topic ID. So you can post messages in the topic ID, and then who is subscribed to that would start getting notification based on the information they provided. It could be SMS, email, or whatever. So I think that is very high, in a very high level and simple way. Like anybody can come and create a channel, put messages, and then anybody who has subscribed will start getting that. Is that fine, Shreyas?
Yeah, it's clear to me. Yeah.
So I have a question. I think I joined a little late, but the question is that how do we ensure that are we ensuring, first of all, that every notification is going to be received? Is that part of our requirement?
When you say receive,
so let's say the client is not online right now, right? So internet permissions or internet issues or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. So in that case, are we assuming all the notifications are going to be eventually received, or is there any consideration like that?
Yes, if you see in the requirements part, we will save it if we face any failure in terms of delivering the notification for a particular topic to a subscriber, then we will retry it actually. So yes, that is a consideration in the design.
Okay, right. And is order one of the considerations? It should be ordered only.
So Rubani has the requirement of priority, but I think Rubani, there could priority and order could be different. So let's say you have two messages of same priority, but does the order matter to you? That is one question. I think for now we can go non-ordered.
Yeah, actually, it is non-order actually, but it's just that the priority should be handled. So if I am getting P1 and P2, P3, so all my P1s should be given to me on priority.
Okay, understood.
Okay. Yeah, hi Mohammed. How will subscriber get to know about the existing topics? Should we add an API for listing topics as well?
Yeah, that's a good point actually. But so they want to, then they have to give the client ID. So if they want to get all the topics from a client, and then they can revert back with the topic to, yeah. So that's a good addition. Yeah, that's a good addition.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I was going to say that we might need to add a link or mapping between subscriber to the topic. We have an API that does the, subscribe with the, onboard API is there, onboard subscribe, which does with SMS number and email. But that particular details or records like SMS or email ID, which topic they want to subscribe for, right? They don't want to subscribe for all the topics in the server or likewise.
So they have that call for subscription. If you want to subscribe for a topic, then we have the call for that actually.
Yeah, but then how does that tie to user? There is a subscribe API, right? Which has a topic name and subscribe ID, but that doesn't tie to user, right? That is not mapped to user, does it?
So they are sending a topic name actually. User as in the person who's producing these notifications?
No, subscriber. I meant subscriber. For example, XYZ subscriber wants to subscribe only for events or topic, which is named as, let's say, ABC. So where are we mapping them? Like XYZ will only get notifications from ABC. Where are we tying that?
So that will come in the design part, that we will be storing that information in the database, and we'll have that information stored as to this subscriber has subscribed to which topics, and then it's only for those topics he will be getting the notification. So we have that mapping in the database, right?
Okay, cool.
So what is the meaning of third row then?
So the question pointed out was that I think we can also include a client ID with which you want to subscribe.
So the third ID is like onboard subscriber, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So what is that API? Who uses this API?
So if you want to add a subscriber to the notification system, but yet we do not want to subscribe. So it's not important that as soon as you get onto the system, you have to subscribe to a topic. And even if you subscribe to a topic, we need your details where we need to send these notifications. So that onboard endpoint is going to handle that.
No, but for one topic, there could be millions of clients or customers, right, who should be receiving this via SMS or email. I think that may be the same question that the other one had before. So how is that dealt in the API? So where are we seeing that? Take for example Instagram. So if Instagram wants to use this service, so they have two different endpoints, right? One is the producing endpoint where you are pushing the notifications, and another is there has to be a way where you need to tell or where you need to duplex all these messages to all the customers. So somewhere you need to tell, okay, these are my customers, and these are the SMS or emails that you need to propagate these messages to. So isn't it the case?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. There should be some tying in between topics versus users, that which all users have subscribed for that topic. And when I say users, there should be some SMS or email should be tied to that particular topic, so that you know that while you want to send a notification, you want to send to like the particular set of user which are subscribed to that particular topic.
I believe.
I think probably you should separate out API in such a way that what is the service API in terms of producer, what are you giving? And in terms of consumption, what API are you giving?
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Maybe if you have logical separation, maybe we can...
Yes.
I think Rabani is still in the requirements gathering.
I think this is API discussion, so once not requirements,
the,
right?
Yeah, once he comes to the design phase, I think he'll design the user data.
I thought this is the API discussion.
Huh? I'm sorry?
I thought this is the API level discussion we are doing, not requirements. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, but this tying up is actually what will happen in the design phase, right? So it's an open notification service, right? So if you, the onboarding service is what says a sign up on a notification service or on any website, it's like Instagram, right? So the example that you gave, you sign up on an Instagram, but in order to get notifications, you need to follow people. But as you do not like sign up and then you start getting notifications, because then you have to subscribe. So these two, onboard and subscribe, are these steps. Onboard is just is equivalent to sign up on the notification on the Instagram, that you have signed up but you have not subscribed to any of the clients or any of the topics. But on subscribe, you say that okay, fine, I will subscribe to this topic from this client. Is it clear, guys?
I still feel something is disconnected. I'm not sure. Maybe as you can go ahead, maybe it will be clear. I'm seeing with respect to API level, because requirements we already discussed, right? So with respect to API, what are the APIs that we are exposing out of the thing? So mm-hmm. I'm thinking.
Okay, it's a good way. Maybe the APIs that I have listed down are not clear in terms of their functionality or their need. So that is something. And one thing is a nice suggestion that we can segregate them on the basis of their logical requirements or on the basis of their use case. So we can have the client ones here that would be used by clients.
So I have one more question. What happens? So how do we ensure the acknowledgement?
As of now, we are not acknowledging that we are not dealing with the acknowledgement as of now.
Okay, then how will we know that some notification failed? Like that we are considering, right?
Yes, we are considering that some notification failed.
So how, like, for that we need acknowledgement, right? Like it is possible that our API call was success, but the notification was not received.
For email, actually, that represents a gap, actually.
So I think we can, I think only right now have, if we were not going in acknowledgement way, like say we couldn't send the message out because the subscriber is not available, then we wait for 3 days and send it, retry it in that way. I think you have something API thing, something you are having. Or if you want to go acknowledgement way, that is also fine. But change the scope of your...
So if it is acknowledgement, how long will we be waiting for the acknowledgement? And in case if the acknowledgement is not done, we'll get stuck there only?
No, we will put that something. We can we can make it invisible for some time. But okay, let's say we are not going in acknowledgement way. Only thing is, if you couldn't send it out, you will keep it for 3 days and try it again within 3 days, and then it is gone.
This failure was what we were handling is that if the system fails, or if the underlying service fails, then we need to retry that. So. And if the user is not available, then we save it for 3 days. But yeah, we need to discuss about the acknowledgement. Okay, fine. We can discuss that as we dive into the design, and then as it comes up, since it's an open discussion, we can always visit that. Okay, so if we look at the design, I would say from a very high level view, we'll have an application server which will host all these endpoints. And to make it highly available, we can have multiple application servers behind a load balancer. So we can have more than one application servers actually. And we need to store the data in a database. So we have to look at the schema of the data as well. So if we look at how we'll be storing. So most of the values that I see that we'll be storing would be the client ID. So it would be client ID, topic name, subscriber ID. So I don't see any requirements for end message. Yeah. So as these are the entities that I would be required to store. In terms of the database tables, I'll have table one, or let's say for one table for clients. That will store the client ID and all the topics of that client actually, those topics that the client has created. Other would be subs list. So let me name this table as subs list. So this will have topic name and the subscribers that are, and the subscriber that are subscribed to the topic. And the table three would be, these are not tables in terms of RDBMS relation database. I'm just talking about the schema. It would be subscribers with their relevant information such as subs ID, email, and then SMS number. So, if we look in terms of the database that we might have to use, I don't really see the requirement to have a relational database. So relational database, they mainly are used to make sure that we follow the asset principles and there's transaction. So I don't really see any requirement of that. Neither do I see the requirements for complex joins. So I would say I would go towards the NoSQL way. So people can pitch in if they feel that we can also use the RDBMS. Plus, this is we are designing a highly available and scalable system. So with NoSQL implementations, we do have the option of scaling very quickly and massively. So that is where I am leaning towards. In terms of NoSQL, we have document type, we have key value, we have columnar, and we have graph. So out of these two requirements, out of these four types of NoSQL database, I'm thinking of going more for either key value or columnar. So this is what I am thinking.
I was thinking an alternate approach, maybe I'm not sure if I can. What if you embed the destination within the message itself? Why do you need to store this and give access to the, because this will be accessed by, this table will be accessed by the service provider, right? I mean, the service provider who is giving service of no notifications or email messages.
Yeah. So yeah, the underlying service would be calling, our application server will be calling this database actually.
So I was just comparing this with my idea of embedding destination details within the message itself.
Okay.
So you mean no SQL database at all?
No, you may still need a database just to keep track of like delays and acknowledgement loss. You may still need it in the on the delivery end. But one advantage I see is like you don't need to look up this table for every message. So because the message itself has the message that you need to send and also the delivery mechanism, like whether it's SMS or an email or whatever.
Yeah. And I need a SQL database for one reason, to store what are the providers and what are the subscribers. That SQL database is like consistent database, right? I mean, like we have to, it won't change immediately, and we can have a SQL database for that.
Yeah, but with the SQL database, we will have issues regarding scalability. And then I was going with the approach that with the asset principles actually, and they are more biased towards that.
To, my SQL database is only limited to storing what are the subscribers and what are the topics present. For these subscribers, for these topics, what are the subscribers? That will not change every day, I feel.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good thought actually. We do not find any harm in using the SQL as well, anyways. Or if someone has any real issues with the pitfalls that we might face using SQL database.
So I like Sid's idea that we can have a separate onboarding service as well, and that can use SQL database just for onboarding of client and subscriber. And other functionality can be taken care by some other service, the application server you have drawn. So
yeah,
those two can be segregated based on the scalability.
That's a good idea. Yeah, that's a good idea that we use SQL database to store the onboarding data, that is mainly clients, and But one more thing is that we also need to store what are the topics that a client has created. So with that, we would require no SQL database or a columnar database, because then you can have a parent column with the client ID and all the topics that the client has already created. So that's the idea actually regarding the choosing key value or columnar, is that we do not have to store the same value again and again if we were to use an SQL database. So that's the main advantage that we would have of NoSQL actually. But yeah, it's a good point that we can, it's a perfectly viable option that we can use SQL for storing the user client onboarding and subscriber onboarding.
So what's the disadvantage of using a NoSQL database for that as well?
For
the subscriber data.
So like I don't actually see any disadvantage, to be honest, with using a key value database, NoSQL database. It perfectly makes sense that we have a key as a subscriber ID and we have a value such as the SMS and an email, actually.
Yeah, that is also can be done.
Yeah.
Can you repeat your point?
Regarding choosing NoSQL for I can have key as a subscriber ID and then value as in the SMS or the email that the subscriber has given. So that works similarly as it's in a table.
Right. So what you're saying is for one corresponding ID, there would be one corresponding device ID or something, right? Is it? Is that what you're saying?
Not device ID. We are catching the subscriber data here. So there would be SMS or email for that subscriber.
Okay, so
how often this table is read?
Actually, not that. Yeah, so we will have most because of the reads from the table that has the topics, this topic name and the subscriber. So we'll have most of the reads from this as well as client and topics. We won't have that much of reads going into the SQL, subscriber detail.
The question that I have is like when there is a message is flowing in, and you have to deliver to the destination, you need to have updated list of clients, right?
Yes, updated list of subscribers.
So even the clients will be growing. I mean, there will be new subscriber for Instagram or any app, and you'll be adding, there will be writes into this table for a particular application. The subscriber list will grow. It's not like it's static, right?
When
that is dynamic, and the messages should be delivered in real time, right? So it has to be near real time delivery has to happen. Mm-hmm. So how frequently are you reading this table?
Okay.
So this was the reason why this was one of the reasons why I was thinking earlier that what if the responsibility of the producer, when he is producing a message, he says that, hey, this message has to be delivered for this client. This particular client, and these are the IDs or email.
What you're pointing out is that the client itself provides the list of all the subscribers that it wants to send.
No, I'm not saying that we should go in that direction, but I was just saying that.
Okay. Yeah.
How would you solve the read problem here? How do you refresh yourself?
I'm just thinking that. Regardless of whether it's a SQL database, relational versus a NoSQL, I see that there is a need for a cache layer with a pre-existing computation.
Yes, we have that actually. It's coming
for
up
every,
in the
for every producer, we do a pre-aggregation, say, you know, who are all the subscribers for that, what kind of preferences they have. And if that information somehow can reside in the pre-aggregated cache layer, that way, like, you know, all the notifications can be sent in the real time. So you don't need to process every time. You don't need to hit the database there. Somehow you need to.
Yeah, but his idea is.
No, it's about the freshness, right?
His idea is, his point is that, let's suppose it's the celebrity example, right? So they keep getting the subscribers of the celebrities, they keep exceeding, like, they keep increasing. So while they keep posting content. So if it is a very sought after topic and you are continuously subscribing to, people are continuously subscribing to that topic, or systems are subscribing to the topic, how do I update my list before sending it out, right? Am I correct? Is this what the question is, right?
Yeah, that's the problem.
Yes. Yeah.
So are you assuming that this list is kind of relatively static and you're going ahead? So what is your assumption there?
I actually did not see in that way that it would be growing dynamically to the point that I need to update my list. But yeah, this is a very good point actually that one needs to consider.
Can I go with an approach? Like, let's say the subscribers growth is increasing rapidly or decreasing rapidly. You can store in the cache memory and cater that request for time being and have some scheduler job to pull the cache memory and insert into the database. Is it the right solution?
But that becomes volatile, right?
Yeah.
You might lose subscribers then.
Okay.
No. I think. See, this is what I'm thinking, right? You will have a user DB, obviously, user table. A subscriber table, with all their preferences. Hey, you know, for this particular topic or notification, I only prefer the SMS. For this one, email. For this one, phone. Right? My preferences will be somewhere. Now, the pre-aggregated cache layer that we are talking about is actually, there will be a polling service between the user DB and cache layer. Anytime that users are growing, you know, for this particular producer or topic, that polling would actually immediately write that information back to the pre-cache layer, and it will build, it will add those subscribers to the pre-cache layer, so that now it always stays on top of the, you know, in dynamic nature. It always captures the new people that are getting added into the system. So do you think that it won't solve the
what is pre-cache layer here? Like, pre-cache is another cache layer.
Pre-aggregated cache layer, but pre-aggregated. I meant to say that you don't build that, you know, like every time that you get a producer message, a notification topic, you don't every time go back to the database and, you know, and pull all the subscribers there.
Uh-huh.
Because
That would fall within the scope of availability, right? So that if you subscribe to a channel, if you subscribe to a topic, you are bound to, if it is a very high available system, then you want the recent subscription to that topic as soon as you subscribe. Correct? That would fall into the being very highly available for anyone. Is that classification right?
I think this is not, maybe it serves for the highly available, but this is for the basic functionality. How does a notification being sent over to all the subscribers that that subscribe to the system?
So,
there has to be something between databases and the notification services, a layer.
So we can, if we can proceed with the design of the, we are going in a lot of directions, guys. So, and why I highly appreciate the input, this is what we have this session for. But okay, let's try to move forward, and then I guess some of your questions will be answered. And if not, then we can delve down to that. If it is fine, can we move ahead, and then we'll visit to the topic, because we haven't gone to this semantic where we are accessing the database. Mm-hmm. We had just designed this. We have just chosen what sort of database we have. We would like to work with, and how the schema in those database would look like. And we haven't discussed how it would be accessed or how it would be updated. So I guess if that's fine, we can.
I think you can go ahead. Maybe you can just state your assumptions. Otherwise, the questions will be popping up and we may end up in different directions.
So I would like to finish up with the design part. And then we can point out where could be the bottlenecks, or where could be the system might not behave as we are expecting it to, right? So coming on to this design part, we have the application servers, and we have a number of, we have our database here. So I would say, yeah.
So this will also sit behind a load balancer. And we will have a cache layer in between these. I'll come back to that. As for when an application, let's say when a client onboards, they'll call the load balancer, our application server behind the load balancer, and we'll register that client into our database. So let's say the call goes to the database, and this is a very high level, and then we'll try to scale it up and make it more precise to what our requirements are. So when a client wants to onboard, they'll call the application server, and the application server will note down their details, that is the client name, and it will give it a client ID. So in the schema, we'll have a client name and a client ID as of now. So now, similarly, the create topic API. So when a client wants to create a topic, so it'll do the same call, and we store the same information in our DB corresponding to the client ID and the topic name. When a subscriber wants to onboard, it would be same. They will call the application server, and we'll note down their SMS number, email ID, and assign them a subscriber ID. Going on to our second topic, second API, the subscriber subscribe. So they will have to pass in the topic name as well as the client ID, actually, in order to subscribe. So they can use this list API, which someone suggested it's a good addition, to list all the topics of a client they want to get, and then they can use this API to get to know the topic name that they want to subscribe. But I guess to someone who's using this notification service, they would pretty much know beforehand which topic they would want to subscribe. But yeah, this is an addition that we'd like to add. Now coming on to how we'll notify if the client wants to notify with a message. So they will call this application server with their client ID, message, and then topic name. So as soon as we get this, we will need to get the list of subscribers, but that's coming later. Afterwards, we will have one service. I'm just trying to let's go with the flow that once we get a notify call on our application server, we'll take that message. There will be priority with this message, actually. So we can actually add a priority here. So this priority will specify P1, P2, P3. Now, in terms of handling these, I will have a message store. In terms of queues, with considerable priorities. So we'll have these queues. Each queue will be having, each queue will cater to one priority. So this is the P1 queue. This would be P2 queue, and this would be P3 queue. So anytime a message comes, we'll save that message in the corresponding queue. And then in order to send that message to the list, to the subscriber that have subscribed to a topic, we can have a sender service, actually, that will do the task for us. So we'll have many of these sender services. Yeah. So each sender service will be responsible for picking up one of the work from the queue that we have stored in the queue and send it out to the subscribers. So how it's going to happen is that we get the message from the client. The application server creates a job and it puts it in our queue based on the priority. So it gives us to this load balancer, and this load balancer on our distributing server, or based on our priority, it will give it to P1, P2, P3. Now these sender services, they are also sitting behind a sort of a load balancer, which will delegate some work to them. So the sender services, they will keep polling this application, this queue server, in order to see if there any message that they want to, that they can use, and this queue service will provide them message based on priority. So if this queue server sees that there is still message in P1, it will first try to empty out P1 queue, because this will contain all the messages that are of P1 priority. So this way the senders will get the messages as per their priority by this queue service. And the senders will, they will have thread pools or executor services, thread executor services, where each executor service will be responsible for sending a message through email or sending it through SMS. In terms of how we'll know that which are the subscribers that we need to send, it's the sender service that will in turn make a call to a cache that we'll maintain. So this sender service will call this cache actually in order to get the list of the subscribers, and this cache will be updated from the database actually for the list of subscribers actually. And in terms of any failures that we face, we said that we will save the notifications for 3 days. So we'll actually have a separate queue for saving the failures and then retrying them afterwards as they are nearing their end time. So Yeah, so if we go over the flow of how the client will notify, so the client sends a notify with its ID, message, priority, and topic name to our application server. The application server creates some sort of a job, or it stores that message. We store that message in our message store. It is the priority queue based on the priority. So that is stored in these priority queues. Now our sender service will always keep polling the priority queue service to see if we have got any messages in there. So this service will always first try to give empty out the P1 queue. So for any requests, as long as there is messages in the P1 queue, those will be sent out first. When a sender service has been given a message, we can sort of lock it here until the point that the sender confirms that, okay, yeah, I have sent it all. So we can remove that from the queue. If not, like if the sender service dies or the sender server fails, then after a prerequisite amount of time, we can release the lock for any other sender service to pick it up. This might result in some duplications, but we have covered that we are fine with duplicacies. We just want the notifications to be delivered. So in that way, they'll be delivered. So as soon as the sender gets a message from the queue, it'll look at the topic name and as well as the client ID. It will ask the cache for a list of subscribers list. And then on the base, it'll get the list of subscribers and it'll spin up thread pools for sending the messages or notifications via email and then via SMS. So this is what I initially thought of when designing this as per the requirements. Do you guys have any questions, or now do we see any pitfalls, or am I able to answer some of your questions?
I have one question here. In the priority key, you are maintaining the messages based on the topic, right?
No, this is based on the priority. I'm not them based on the topic.
So suppose, it is user-based message you are sending, or on a topic-based message you are keeping on the priority queue?
I didn't get your question.
On the mouse pointer, we have queue, right? All three queue are there. P1, P2, P3, three queue are there.
Yeah.
So this contain that messages based on the topic, right?
They contain the messages. Yeah. Based so it's not like that P1 will be containing only topics towards all the messages for just one topic. P1 will be containing all the messages from any client as long as it's P1 in priority.
Yeah, so don't you think it is the bottleneck here? But because what you are doing is that you are picking up one messages from the priority key to keep on trying sending. If message till it is successful deliver, then till the time that queue is locked, right?
So only it's not that queue is locked. We can say that that first element of the queue is logged, something like that. Actually, if you look at the RabbitMQ or the RabbitMQ implementation, so we can have that functionality. We can implement that functionality either using database as well, that if you are reading anything, you can log just that particular value, so that any other sender can still read other values and work on that.
Okay.
This is an abstraction actually. Okay. Not particularly queue, but yeah. So get this, that if there's a P1, if there's T1, T2, T3, T4, sorry, M1, M2, M3, M4, all of our priority one. So M1 might be getting read from sender one. So M1 might be logged. So that with that mechanism, sender two can come in and there won't be any race condition or concurrency issues, and sender two can still read the M2. Now, under the circumstance that sender one fails or goes down, so we do not want that to be stayed in logged state, and we want the notifications to be delivered, because we said that we will deliver all the subscribers the message that they have. So we will have some timeout, and after that we will release that lock actually, so that any other sender can now pick that up and keep working. The only thing it will happen, it will lead to is having some duplicacy, but we are fine with some level of duplicacy.
Okay, so what is it other key you are doing behind that sender two are there?
Yeah, so let's say if you are sending to a particular subscriber, it is that this was designed with the mind that we will have failures when we are sending. So even now, if we have to save the notification for 3 days if it is unsuccessful. So we'll save this in these queue with a timestamp or with a timer. So the sender service will also poll these queues to see that if there is any message that is nearing its expiration, and then it can pick that up and send it again. So this is only for this will store email one and this will store SMS one. Or okay. We can just do just one, we'll have both. We can also do that.
Okay. So in this case, we don't require to lock any message on this first queue, three queue you have maintained, right? You just pick up the messages from there and keep it in this bottom of sender queue. And after it successfully delivered, then delete from the queue. Okay, if not delivered, then you keep on trying from there.
So you are saying that we read it from here, we do not lock it.
Yeah.
And if we fail it, we save it here.
Yes, right. No, we save it here and try for sending from there. If it is successful, then delete the message from the same bottom of the queue. Otherwise, it is not successful. Then we keep put this message. It can be retrieved by
for 3 days. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That is also a good idea. Yeah.
Yeah. But in that case, you're growing that second queue in the order of how many messages you're receiving, right? But if you just lock it and you just insert the erroneous messages which failed to deliver in that P2, then you are growing it only for the messages that failed. So you would incur less costs.
Yes.
And there is a basic difference between these two queues, right? I think the first set of queue that you have, the left side, is not multiplexed in the sense that if one subscriber, you are sending one message for one subscriber, I mean, not subscriber, the service.
Topic.
And that service may have thousands or even millions of subscribers. Isn't it? Is my understanding correct?
I didn't get your question clearly.
When you send a message in the first three sets of queues, right? So that is for one service, right? And you have to duplex after this. Because you are fetching the service, you are fetching the customer ID and email IDs, and then you are duplexing. It's not duplex. What do you call it? Broadcast.
Broadcasting. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Broadcasting.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
The second queue, that second set of queue below, that's basically individual failures. Right. It's not it's not similar to the first set of queues.
Yeah. It's not. Yes. Yes. That's correct. So this is my attempt to make sure that we still do not have although duplicacy is allowed, but this is my attempt at designing where we can reduce some level of duplicacy actually. Yeah. This
now, one concern I have here is this is the design, right? The sender, because one sender picks up a message from this queue.
From right? the main
yeah,
queue.
Yeah. Okay. And for each message, he is the sole responsible for dealing with all the customers for that service, which is like a overkill for this guy. You are not distributing the load there, right? Because for a given service, all the subscribers, mm-hmm. you are dealing it in one single node.
Okay. So what you're trying to say is that for, let's say for one topic, one message, I am making one sender as the sole responsibility, as a sole responsible person
yeah.
to broadcast to all those subscribers for that topic. Okay.
So you're not parallelizing, right? There is no horizontal scaling there.
So I am actually spinning up some thread pools inside my sender to.
But still, it's a single node, right? It's a single node.
It's still single node. Yes, that's correct.
And if something fails to that, then how are you going to deal with that?
So, so if something fails to that, so there are two ways to address that scenario, right? If something fails in terms of the, you are saying the underlying node fails, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if that underlying node fails, that message is still in the log state at the primary queue. And after some time, it will be released. So some other sender can then pick it up. But so I get your point. This might seem as a bottleneck where we are making one sender the sole responsible person for broadcasting to all the subscribers for a particular topic. I understand that. Do you have any design considerations for picking that up, for solving that up?
Yeah, one thing I was thinking of is when you get a message from the client, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can actually get the cache there itself,
mm-hmm.
and you are fanning out. Basically, you are creating all the messages which are fanned out for all of your subscribers and then pushing that into the queue.
Mm, okay, so fanning out in the sense that if there are 10,000, yeah. let's say, subscribers, so yeah. I create...
So you will have 10,000 messages in the queue.
Okay, but
so in that way, right, that has one that
queue.
That's okay because you have to process them, right? You have to, because one of the requirements is to guarantee delivery, right? So you need to have them in the queue. So one advantage of doing that way is like each of these messages are independently handled, and you can also have horizontal scaling. Like any sender can pick up any message from the queue, and you get automatically horizontal scalability.
We can think in that direction as well. So go ahead.
Yeah, but it is equivalent to same thing here, right? If any sender pick up any messages, then it will be ultimately pull off all the subscriber, and that sender will be sent all the subscriber here, right? It is
as I was saying, that creates bottleneck on one server, right? So one server, how many of our threads that it's running is solely responsible for dealing with all the subscribers for that service. And if something happens, either you will retry everything, which will create duplicated messages and other things, right? And there may be a chances of missing out sending messages to some of the clients.
Don't you think in the first approach, we'll have multiple calls, like, so we'll have... the queue service will have like multiple calls because I don't feel too confident about having. Let's say at a point we have three topics, each topic is subscribed by, let's say, 5,000 users. So will we be having 15,000 messages in this queue? And
yeah, because you need to guarantee, right? At the end of the day, you need to guarantee that these messages is delivered to people. Right.
That is also being guaranteed in our first approach, right? But we are having some level of duplicacy in that sense.
Not just duplicacy, right? It's not not scaling well. It's like you're linearly processing it in one node. You're not parallelizing it.
I think we can also do it.
Yeah, so Prasanth, how are we duplicating it and assigning it a different destination in parallel?
So what I'm saying is when the client posts something, right, in the first and the above diamond thing, right, I'm saying, can we do the fanning out there itself?
Yeah, I understand
and then
that
pushing
logic.
It out under the
I just want to know, so while duplicating those messages, the number of subscriber times, how will that server handle it? Means how will you make sure every subscriber destination is provided there and it is not linear, it is in parallel. So how you will do that in parallel, that I want to understand.
So now you have, see, these sender services, right? Sender hosts can latch onto this queue. And all the sender nodes can actually subscribe to this topic and they can read parallelly.
Yeah, I agree.
It's not like it's not bound to one sender.
Yeah, I understood your point that all senders can read these messages and consume in parallel and provide that. I'm asking while creating those messages n number of times, if n is the number of subscribers, how will you do that in parallel while creating message? That had to be done in parallel. Otherwise, this approach is not better than the first one. If we are not duplicating those messages in parallel, it will be linear. It will take the same amount of time what we were doing in the first approach.
No, but I believe that processing is much faster, right? Because anyway, you're reading it from cache. You're just basically translates to every write is translates to whatever number of subscribers you have, those many writes into the queue.
So
I don't think that's a bottleneck.
Yeah, yeah, I understood your point. So while duplicating from cache, people do it linearly, but that will be fast. And then sender can do it, process it in parallel and do this. Okay, that's
right.
Yeah.
But the downside of this this issue and the solution of that, we need to add multiple messages of same type to the our queue, right?
Yeah, that is what so I am thinking actually. This will have like a...
See, eventually, if you see the secondary queues that you have, right? Eventually, you're also doing the same thing. See, when there is a failure, you are pushing them onto the secondary queue.
But I'm not... but this, again, this secondary queue won't be having, it will having one actually message. It won't be having, let's say, 10,000 messages if we go with the first approach.
No, but you are storing only those messages. For example, if sender is unable to contact SMS gateway, so you are pushing that onto this queue, right? So it's for only that subscriber, right? Only that destination.
Yes,
you're
only
not
for that
putting it everything.
Everything, yeah. No, only
so
for
I'm saying, exactly the same. So you just, instead of doing that here, you're doing that here.
Yeah, but then we are doing it here on every call, right? We are doing that here.
See, there is a trade-off, right? So there is a trade-off, right? If you want to guarantee the delivery,
okay,
then you can do that. Or yeah.
Okay.
I have another approach on based of what Prasanth is saying, right? Same thing can be done without duplicating the message, okay? So once messages come, right, we have another services can run as a load balancer type of thing. So that will pull all the subscriber of that topic, okay? And based on the user ID, it can be pull, select one of the sender from the cluster, okay? And send and ask the sender to send a message. And keep on doing till it will pass to all the subscriber. Okay, so in this case, we are not going to be populate all the messages and map the messages to the user and put into the queue. Just keep the pull the messages from the queue, and the services in between that sender and this queue will be connected to the all the subscriber database also, and pull all the database subscriber who are subscribed to that topic, and based on the user ID, select one sender and ask the sender to send a message. So here we can save the duplicacy.
Okay. Okay.
Got my point?
Yeah,
that's a better approach.
So we are saying that we'll have one sender here, one service in between here, right?
Yes. And it will be connected to database.
Okay.
You can make it like a pooling services. You can message and rename pooling application.
Okay,
and this will connect to database. Yeah, that is fine.
Okay, yeah.
And this will be connected to the your this queue, and okay. This will connect to the sender also.
Uh-huh.
Yes, like that. And other connection, you don't have to break it. That is your application to the queue, right? That should be there. Yeah, like that.
So what yeah. This?
So the role of these services, you can just pulling services. It will be can pull the all the subscriber of the topic, and schedule who pick up one of the sender and ask the sender to send a message.
Oh.
So now it's not a single point of failure.
Yeah, you can make it.
We can have multiple
primary secondary run services running here. So
yeah, okay. Okay, I got it.
And the load on this server also not much. It's just pulling, just scheduling it. Okay, it is not role to sending. It is not waiting also. But the sender services are heavily loaded because they have to send a message when wait for acknowledgement. And here you don't have to wait for anything.
Okay. Yeah, this looks good. Okay, fine. We'll add that. Any other suggestion, guys?
So I still have the same question, like how so are we reading cache for each and every message?
Yes, we are, because we need to get the list of subscribers for...
and that's very bulky also, right? It's not like a key value pair, simple key value pair, isn't it? Because you basically have millions of subscribers. For every read, are you reading all the subscribers?
So it is a columnar database. So for topic, we will have the list of subscribers. So we'll get the list of subscribers in just one read.
How frequently we do that? Is it for every message or maybe every?
Yeah. So before sending every message, we need to Yeah, for every message we do that. Every message that we get from the client and not the replicated message that we get, that we will put in the priority queue. So if we get one message from the client, although we have replicated that message, but we will get we'll read the database only once. Because in one go only we'll get all the subscribers.
What is this cache? You're saying columnar. There is no columnar. I have not heard of any
columnar. Oh, sorry. Cache. No, database. Sorry. I mean to say database. Yeah, but we'll be hitting cache actually. Sorry. I was saying.
No, but cache, how can it store? Can it store all the subscribers in one key entry?
No.
Yeah, memcache we can use it right here.
Yeah, we can use.
Memcache are what is?
No, but typically in this case, the entry is very bulky, right? I'm not sure if it's cacheable or what's the size of this. How does the size ends up to?
Yeah, even I'm not sure how much size a value can be even in Redis cache. I'm not sure about that. But still, I think it looks okay because we can have multiple cache servers there. So basically, I'll be taking responsibility of to which topic all the subscriber will be there. But regarding
it's not about load balancing, right? The problem here is individual key itself is growing.
A key is not growing. A key topic name. Value is growing. Value is the list of subscribers.
Yeah. I mean, the value for one key is it could be large.
I'm not sure how much value size a Redis server can handle, if anyone here is aware about that. But I think it allows a value up to a good amount of size. Someone said 512 MB in chat.
And basically, so this should have the email ID and email ID and phone numbers, right? Basically, we'll have email ID and phone numbers.
We will be having yes, email ID and phone numbers.
We will just need subscriber ID in the cache, right? We don't need to store all the information. Just subscriber ID efficient.
So we need email ID, right? Otherwise,
yeah, how we will need sender email ID and email.
That eventually you have to read.
That sender can we can go with that route that that sender can figure out by fetching from database. But in cache, for the size restriction, we can just allow to store only subscriber ID. And being on the subscriber ID, sender can fetch other details from the database.
There is another hit required.
Yeah, actually, that's correct. So anyway, we'll be having cache miss. It's not like we will be completely mitigating the cache miss, actually. We will be having cache miss.
Can we have a correlation between topic ID and the subscriber ID while inserting into database itself? That will reduce a lot of work. So for example, my topic is cricket and ID is one. So all the subscribers having one, I just need to send them that message, that notification.
So you want to save the topic information with the subscriber only.
Instead of topic name, right? We should have topic ID.
Topic
for example,
ID, yes. Okay,
yeah,
yes.
Cricket.
Yeah.
The topic is cricket. And the ID is one. So in my database, I have a subscriber with one value in, let's say, first position. So starting from one, cricket ID is one. So all the ones, I just need to grab it and deliver the notification. That makes it really easy.
Yeah. So we can have here, instead of topic name, we can have topic ID. Okay, this will reduce some load. Okay guys, this is what we have I had envisioned in terms of
yeah.
That.
I think we
have exceeded time, right?
No, we are till 11.
Okay.
So one thing is, right, I want to ask you, like, did we design a durable system? Because the primary goal was to deliver the message. So whatever notification we are trying to deliver, it must deliver. So how are we making sure that it is delivered? So the acknowledgement part should be there at least. That's what I'm thinking.
Yes.
Because in the entire session...
Sorry to interrupt. I need to stop the recording, but we can continue the discussion.
Sure.